Hey everybody, it's Retro Gaming Now, and we are back with realMyst Masterpiece Edition. So we're going to go find another book, and we know this, to start that we have to rotate the tower properly, so let's see what we want to do. We could do Rocket Ship, we've already done Gears, we could do Planetarium, we could do Tree. Let's do Tree. Got to open up the tower. And head on up. So now we know for sure that this book symbol does indicate where the book is hidden. And it should be hidden in the tree. Yes, it indeed is. Let's go back to the key to figure out where specifically. Or how. A clue to get there. 724. The only place that I could see that being used is the cabin by the tree, where there was that safe in the back with the instructions. With a three-digit combination. So 724 is probably the combination for that. Since we have no other option, that's where we're going to head on out to. So let's open up the library. And head on out. So it was 724. Let's go ahead and enter that in. Oops. And indeed that works. And what do we get? Matches. Myst matches. Oops, so we gotta strike the match. And let's light the pilot light. There we go. So we've got an image of the tree out back. We have a PSI, so this seems to adjust pressure for something. So let's turn this up a little bit. So now pressure's going way up. There's something going on outside. And it's our tree. It's rising. And we just missed it. So we gotta turn our pressure down. So that tree apparently is not real. If we can so easily. Like, there's a thing in it, an elevator. Also, somehow it's getting power. Not quite sure how that works. Well, let's go ahead and get in it. There's a button here. And indeed, there is a secret compartment, secret passageway down here. So we've got a thing here, so if we want to, we can send the tree back up, looks like. Yep, there it goes. Anyway, now that we're here, we've got another linking book. Of course, first we've got to read up on the age. I forgot about that. So, unfortunately, we can't head up yet. So we've got to head on over to the library first. Now I wish I hadn't turned the pressure all the way up. There it is. So I wonder if this button will just send me back up. Nope, so we have to turn the pressure up and then head on in. Or, how do we do this? That is up, right? It's gotta go this way. Do I have to push it? That's funny. I've never gotten stuck down here. Well, obviously that way is not right, so let's turn it that way. This can't be a glitch. Maybe we can't read up. Alright, looks like we're going to the Channelwood age. And here we are. This age looks considerably better than it did originally. Much better. I actually really like this. Feels a lot more lush. Alright. So we've got all these sort of pipeways on the ground. We can... looks like we can sort of flip where it's going. But it doesn't seem like there's anything running through it. So I don't hear anything. Hear any water or anything, unless it's steam. Looks like there is a second level up there. At least part of it. So let's go head on over to this windmill and see if we can figure out how to turn the water on. Alright, so yeah, our windmill's turning this thing. Not quite sure what this is doing. But we do hear it coming. So let's go ahead and turn the faucet on. And there we go, now we've got water coming straight through. So we can sort of route it different ways. Let's route it this way. And see what we can do here. Alright, so it's powering this generator. But it's for something up there, so that's not going to help us right now. So let's go ahead and flip it this way, and then continue down the path. It's already going this way, so let's see what we've got here. This path goes straight into the water, so that's not going to help us at all. This goes to, looks like, another generator out there. Let's see what that does. This is a pathway, so we can walk around. First, I'm going to go shift the water back just around, because there's not much we can do here anyway, so let's just head on around the other way and see what we can do with the water, since we've turned it on. Flip it this way. It's already going this way, so that's good. This way is also where we want to go. Except for there's nothing there. Whoa. So there's nothing that way, so let's flip the water over here. And we'll just follow this way first. So it's going straight into the water. So maybe we can head on out on that pathway we made and connect the pipe. Hopefully we should be able to do that. Yeah, I do think this age looks a lot nicer than it did. It's very foggy, that's for sure. The noises are pretty much the same as they were in this, though. Alright, head on back over here and connect this pipe. Alright, there we go. Now get power over to this elevator-looking thing over here. Looks like it's an elevator. It should be. Let's go ahead and get in here. Up we go. Close the door first. And here we've got our Myst book. So at least we know how to get back. I'm going to go ahead and head back and read about the age first, though. We haven't done that. Alright, so we're going to go ahead and read about the Channelwood Age. And here it is, the Channelwood Age. Let's see how long this is. Not super long. I have called this age Channelwood and this very different world. Though it is exactly how I imagined it, it is still amazing to see with my own eyes. Water covers this age as far as I can see, except for a small rocky island. Elsewhere, there are only trees which grow directly out of the water. A myriad of thin wooden passageways are built just above the water and disappear into the forest. I assume they were built some time ago, for they appear aged. I am eager to discover more about this land and its people, but I have arrived here late and I must rest. I was awakened this morning by strange noises coming from a pathway adjacent to the one on which I had slept. I saw a group of monkey-like people heading in my direction. They had not seen me yet. I did not feel threatened by their presence. Their response to me was one that I would have never expected. After staring at me for a short time, they fell to their knees and began what appeared some sort of ceremonial worship. I tried to speak to them, but they did not understand my language. Instead, they indicated through enthusiastic hand motions that I was to follow them. As we walked, I began to notice that the waters below us were changing colors. Slowly, subtly, they would change from deep blue to muddy orange, then from muddy orange to beautifully clear. I was so intrigued by the water, I hardly noticed we had arrived at a ladder. Climbing the ladder led us to their village, which is about 10 meters above the water and can only be reached by rope ladders that stretch from lower paths to the village level, approximately halfway up the grand trees. It was very interesting watching these people carry out their daily tasks. Even after watching them for hours, they did not understand exactly what they were doing. At sunset, they motioned for me to follow them. I followed the creatures to the doorway of the enormous hut. Strangely, once inside, I felt that the hut appeared even larger than it had from the outside. The walls were garnished with bright metals, and in the center of the hut sat the leader of these people. At least he appeared to be their leader, for he sat a meter off the floor in a thick throne. Guards surrounded the strong creature, who was dressed in many exotic, colorful fabrics. Next to the leader sat a very old human, at least to some extent he appears human. His hair, which was only on his face and head, was completely gray, almost white, and hung very low around his frail body. His thin head hung limply by almost a grotesque neck that could not hold its head up to look at me. But what a surprise, this creature could speak my language. Shortly thereafter, I was given a bed and some hand motions that looked to be telling me to go to sleep. I look forward to learning more. As I suspected, the ancient creature is a human, but he is old beyond his own reckoning, and it seems almost insane. However, the tree dwellers almost revere him as a god. They are treating me now in the same fashion, which makes me feel very uncomfortable. It is almost impossible to understand the old man. His voice is feeble but wild. He has adopted much of the language of the tree dwellers. He himself told me he had not spoken our own tongue in ages. Is that supposed to be a pun? He attempted to explain to me the history of this place. The following is my best translation of what he told me. Many years ago, the humans and tree dwellers lived together in this place, which was then a vast island. They interacted very little. The humans dwelt on the ground, and the tree dwellers lived high above the humans. Occasionally, the island was disturbed by mysterious rumblings, which happened randomly, some sort of tectonic or volcanic action, I suspect. The sometimes slight, sometimes heavy tremors would last only a short time. Then they would stop, allowing everything to return to normal. One day, things changed. The rumbling began and grew quickly to unprecedented levels. Soon it became apparent that the entire island was sinking slowly into the ocean around them. Many of the humans died that day, but not before sacrificing themselves in order to stop the sinking of the island. The humans who lived through this catastrophe moved into the trees where they gradually died out, maybe because they were unequipped for such an environment, but I'm not sure. This is the story the old man communicated to me, although many details are very unclear in my mind. I'm especially confused as to how the humans saved the island from completely sinking. In fact, I doubt the accuracy of that part of the story. The island must have stopped on its own. Yet the old man believes in the truth of the story as if he had been there, and the tree dwellers worship him, and apparently all humans, if they were heroes or gods. The old man ended our conversation today with an event which I will never forget. He began gripping my hands tightly and murmuring something about rest and asleep. Then he said, "We had expected you to come sooner." These actions filled me with a sort of immediate dread. With much effort, he stood to his feet. I tried to help him, but he pushed me away with more force than I imagined his frail body contained. The tree dwellers quietly surrounded him with very solemn faces. They then kneeled before him. He walked to each and placed his hand on their heads. All the while, he murmured words which I did not understand. Finally, he turned to me and smiled. Then he closed his eyes and walked out the door and off the narrow path high in the trees. The tree dwellers were silent. They began a procession down the nearest rope ladder. As I was descending, I saw several of them pick up the body he had fallen to a lower level of the walkway and carried away. He was laying down at the dead end of the short pier-like structure. With the use of some potion, one of the tree creatures lit the pier on fire, and I watched the flames as the flames engulfed it. As the strange funeral proceeded, the waters around the pier changed to dull green. This morning I awoke, finding it hard to even believe the previous evening's events. The water is a dull green for as far as I can see now. For some reason, the water no longer shifts color. As I wander throughout the pathways, the creatures watch me, curious to see what I will do next. They're constantly offering me strange objects of affection. I even found food outside the doorway to the room at which I had slept. This is a unique race of beings. I hope to learn their language soon so that I may learn from them. I have lived on this world for 3 months off and on. The tree dwellers have shown great hospitality. I'm even beginning to learn bits of their language. I've decided to return home for an extended stay with my loving wife and sons, and hopefully return with them. However, I'm sure Catherine will once again refuse. I think this age would be a wonderful experience for them all, and I at least look forward to having how Sirius and Akinar will react to his curious inhabitants. Catherine is staying behind, as expected. My sons have returned with me, and they enjoy this age very much. They get along very well with the tree dwellers and are picking up their language surprisingly fast. I have no doubt that it will not be too long before they can speak with the tree dwellers much better than myself. I am leaving tomorrow to check the Osmoian age. Sirius has suggested that I allow him and his brother to stay. Though the idea unsettles me, I know the boys are growing up rapidly. The hospitality of these creatures is such that I could think of no better place to leave them alone for a short while, so I will consent to their request. I warn the boys not to take advantage of the respect the tree dwellers have for their ideas. They seem to understand my warning, and I have faith they will follow it. Much to my dismay, upon arriving in the Everdunes, I learn that Pran and her people are continuing to be menaced by the Choctic. I fear for their survival and plan on returning to her shortly. After checking on Sirius and Akin are here. See Everdunes Journal for more information. So that's probably one of the ages that got destroyed, sorry. After watching Sirius and Akinar, I see they're handling things quite well, and I can put to rest any fears they about leaving them in Channelwood again. And for a little longer time. The tree dwellers seem slightly distressed that I'm leaving, but I'm happy that Sirius and Akinar are staying behind again. I've been gone for over 3 days and have been to many different places. I had to tell Sirius and Akinar about Pran's death today, and they were visibly shaken, although they only remembered her from their childhood. Catherine suggested that it would be wise for Sirius and Akinar to leave Channelwood for a while, and I have to agree. They'll be returning with me when I leave again. I've told my sons that they'll be returning with me in 2 days. They spent the entire night telling me of an adventure they experienced in my absence, and it was rather remarkable. It seems they constructed a boat with their creatures and traveled some ways out into the surrounding waters. I enjoy hearing them talk excitedly of their adventures, and reminded of my own adventures as a child. I finally understand why the tree dwellers have been giving me their many inks and insisting I write with them, so that's why these are all different colors. Looking through some of the past entries, I see now that the inks have changed from the black I thought they were to various different colors. I've shown some of the creatures my journal, and they laughed and howled. I did not know they had such a sense of humor. Even now, as I look through this very colorful journal, I cannot help but laugh myself. We will be returning tomorrow, so my sons are with the creatures for the last night here. They've told me they would like to come to Channel 1 again, and also asked if they can visit some other ages alone. Though I will have to think over their request, I believe they've proven to me they are trustworthy and responsible. Catherine will also have to help me decide whether they are ready for travel alone. For now, I must give my farewells to the creatures, for I do not know how long it will be until I visit this age again. So here we've got a little diagram which shows a future bridge, as well as a dotted line for something else. And some pictures. There's the windmill, and there's one of the things in the trees. So, sorry, that was kind of a long journal, but it was kind of interesting. So when we were there, we didn't actually see any tree dwellers for some reason. Not sure why that was. Up. So we gotta make this in time. I wonder if this button reduces pressure. That might be what it does, hopefully. Yeah, there we go. No, alright. So it only takes it down to that level. So we're just gonna let it go up a couple of ways, then we're gonna turn the pressure off. So now we should have a little bit of pressure that we can just get straight in this. So we haven't, it seems like all the ages we have seen so far are entirely covered in water. Obviously, Channelwood is, but so was the Mechanical Age, which a name was never actually given to. So let's get down here and head back. Things should be just as we left them. Sorry for that detour. It's a bit inefficient, but off we go. Alright. So, I think that we have to find where our water supply is right now. Alright, so it's heading this way. I think we probably want to go to this elevator, because we know that that elevator over there just leads us back to the Mistbrook. So let's take this elevator here. Here we are, so these are the upper levels, I think, probably, that Atrus was referring to in his journal. Let's see what we've got here. Not much. Sort of like a wooden... Yeah. Got some benches. Still nothing really here. There are no monkeys. That's kind of strange. Let's keep walking around. Maybe we can find something. It's very empty. That's the best word, I think, to use for this sort of area. Let's go to that building over there. That sort of hut thing. And some pots. Seems very, very, yeah, empty is the best word. Let's head out this way. We haven't been here yet. Nope, nothing in here either. Here we've got something. An elevator. And a doorway down. I think. Nope. Let's get in the elevator. Does it work? No, it does not. Can we just jump off here? No. Surprised we can't just jump off, but whatever. So, if there's no way to open this, let's keep exploring. Really not much to do up here, is there? That's the Myst book room over there. There's another sort of elevator. Is that the one we came up from? I don't know. It's easy to, like I said, it's sort of easy to get lost in this age. Especially if you don't have a map, which I don't. But let's go see this elevator. I think that's the one we came up from. Yeah, it is. I'm very surprised that we can't open that door we saw over there. Maybe we need... Because the thing is, we need a way to get down. Without using any power, because we need to turn on the power for the elevators that go up to the third level that we saw over there somewhere. Yeah, you can see the third level up there. But I don't know if a good way to get that right now. Is there anything out here? Nope. Yeah, I'm gonna head back over to that door that looked like there were stairs down, because maybe Maybe there is a way to get up. Yeah, so this here. I'm very surprised I can't open this door. And since I can't open it, I'm gonna actually just have to go ahead and head back down, because there might be something else I'm missing down at the bottom. So we'll head back again in this direction. There's the elevator right over there. It's nice they have a sprint key, which is what I'm using right now. This is very... It's kind of amazing these walkways stay up. They're not very... They don't look very reliable. I did that inefficiently. Like, they're sort of just floating in midair. Like, these make sense because they're rope ladders, but... That one over there is sort of just floating. So we're going to remember that staircase we saw over there and just head back down, see if there's anything we can do. So that is the Myst Island making book. Where's the staircase? I think it's this way. Alright, so this goes straight into the ground, so does this power something up there? I don't know, but if it does, it doesn't help me right now. So let's go ahead and flip it the other way. And I believe this would go... No, we don't want that, do we? Also, Atrus doesn't mention these are water power things in his journal. Ah, here we go. So let's flip it this way. Is this what we needed to do all along? The issue is we can't open this. So what this probably does is power that elevator that's up there. The thing is, we need to figure out a way to get up without using that. Without using power. I actually don't remember what you're supposed to do on this one, so I'm just going to figure it out the old-fashioned way. Let's just keep playing with what happens if we go all the way this way. I wonder if there's multiple elevators up. That's almost possible. So this elevator, I think, just goes up. Yeah, that's the elevator up. So we need to go head it this way. So that's our Myst elevator, though. I guess I'm just going to have to head up one more time and see if there's anything I'm missing. Got day-night cycles, that's kind of cool. It's starting to get dark. Yeah, the issue is there's no way. We need to flip where the power is while we're up here. We don't know a way of doing that right now. And it's starting to get dark, so it might get hard to see in a minute. Ah, here we go. That opens that door. So that is what we needed to do. That is what that little dashed line represented on the journal that we read. So let's head on over there. I think it's this way. Maybe. Yep, there it is. Alright, so now we should be able to... direct the power straight to this elevator and go up to the third level. Whoa. It's gonna be dizzying. Ooh. So if we press F, we can turn our flashlight on. I don't know if I did that yet. That's kind of useful. I like the little fireflies. It's kind of a cool touch. So now we just gotta, oops, flip this that way. And that should power our elevator to get us up to the third level. Even with the flashlight, it's kind of annoying to... But, alright, let's head on up. Very high up, you can hear the wind howling. That looked like Akinar doing some of his barbaric. Whatever. This is the mask we saw in that in a mechanical age. It's like some sort of a sacrificial thing. That was quite interesting, to say the least. Let's head on back this way. Sleeping hut. As we could tell with all these, like, jackals and nails and stuff. And a very bare bones bed. And there's this page. That's what we've got here. Maybe he's speaking the bird language or the monkey language.
I hope I pushed the right button. Very interesting device. I'm not erasing anything important, am I? He is preparing. Remember, take only one page.
And that was Sirius. Or Sirius, sorry. Nice moon. We got what we came for. So let's head on back down. This is a pretty long age, to be honest. And down we go. Head back to Myst. Just take the stairs down, it's the faster way. In fact, it's the only way. Right now. Dizzying stairs. So now we need to route the water all the way over to our Myst book. So we'll have to flip this one. And I believe it's going the correct way right now. Yeah. So we gotta flip this one. head on back around the other side and take the walkway over. It's kind of cool. You can't really... It's hard to tell that there's a third level from the bottom. I mean, you definitely couldn't tell in the original myths. Like, you couldn't really look up, but... It's interesting. I kind of like how they did that. Alright, let's head back up. There we go. Alright, let's put this in the blue page and see what Akinar has to say.
Good. The more blue pages you find, bring more. I must have some more. That's all I ask of you. Long. It's been so long since my brother, Cirrus, wrongfully imprisoned me within this book. Stupid schemes. Pretty speech. Greed, which is endless. Obvious to you. He's done evil and he has destroyed all before. Do not bring the red pages to him. You must not let him trick you. He tricked our father. Hideously murdered our father. He'll trick you. He'll murder you. Touch the red pages. I beg you to bring the blue pages to me. Listen, you must obey me. Blue pages are my only hope. You must help me. You must help me.
So, Akinar claims that Cirrus killed Atrus, their father. But we know that that can't be true, because Atrus was mentioned in his imager speech about how he had to imprison the boys. He also demands that we do not free Cirrus. But we're going to have to hear his side of the argument as well, so we have to head back to Channelwood. Raise this up a little bit. Should be good. And head on out. I still don't really know where they get electricity from. Back to Channelwood we go. Alright, so we've got to head back up to the second level, which means we're going to have to route the water to our stairway, because that's where the elevator is. So to do that, we need to go over this way. And I think we only have to flip one switch on this one. Yep. Then we can head up the dizzying staircase. I believe this was an animation in Myst, the original Myst, if I remember right. So it automatically just took you up the staircase. Yeah, where the power comes from, I don't know, honestly. Maybe the generator, I guess. I don't know. So let's go get the red page now. To do that, we're going to have to go through this room again. Oh, no, we won't. Actually, I think we have to go this way. I think there's a second way to go. No, there's not. Anyway, I know he's up here. It's up here somewhere. Ah, there it is. The back way. This is Cirrus's room. Much, much nicer. He's actually got like a quill. Ink. He's got this cool floating ball thing. Or not floating. Sculpture. Of course, nice lamps. His own sink. He actually brushes his teeth like Akinar. A nice bed. Of course, some alcohol. Lots of alcohol. Can we open these drawers? Yes, we can. So he's got his dagger. More alcohol. And here we have something. Something Vault Excess, something of Myst. In very plain view, something Myst, and Excess can be something if the simple something followed. First locate something switches on the island, something if the switches to the something go to the clock, or dock and something, marker switch something off position. So, there's obviously another half of this hidden somewhere else that we have not found. So we'll go ahead and remember that, and then when we find the other half, we'll take it. So here we've got some rotten cheese, so obviously people haven't been here for a while. Nothing in this drawer. And some smashed chairs. So I wonder what's going on here. And in this drawer, we've got some more ink, and we've got the red page. You can see the windmill from down there. I actually really like this room. I think it's probably one of my, favorite little places. This stage. Yeah, Cirrus rooms always are so cozy, if that's the word. Alright, so let's head back to Myst and see what Cirrus has to say about Akinar. I wonder what happens if someone turns the power off while you're in the elevator. That's a good question. Down we go. There's no easy way to do this on it, unfortunately. Maybe if I had the clip, like keyframes, because there's the option to just like you click on a location, it takes you there, sort of like the original Myst. They have all the sections or camera angles predetermined. Yeah, I'm actually sprinting right now. This is what it looks like when I'm not sprinting. This is good for, like, exploring, but when we're trying to get somewhere, not so much. So, if we remember from what Atrus said, apparently there are other islands out here that the boys sailed out to. Still not really any sign of the tree dwellers at all. Of course, it's possible that Akinar was sort of intimidating them with all of his messages. Alright, let's head on back to Myst. Alright, let's give it to Cirrus.
Have returned. Additional page. on this forgotten island of Myst. I see that you are. I am called Sirius. I need all the red pages. I know. Must search and bring two more for the red. I am released. I promise. Don't touch the blue pages. That is where my mind was. For my wicked brother. Man of distorted mind and senses. He disgusts me. Do not release Akna. Thirst for destruction is none. Never ending. Bring the red paper. May you please release me. From this prison, I promise you will be greatly rewarded. Must help me.
So he called, Sirius called Akinari man of distorted mind and senses, I think it was. And from what we've seen, that does seem to be pretty true. However, we do know that Sirius does seem to have issues with things like drinking and stuff like that. Alright, so we finished the Channelwood Age. This has been Retro Gaming Now. As always, if you enjoyed, rate, comment, subscribe. And I think for our next video, we are going to try and figure out how to use this rocket ship. Alright, thanks.